This is a little prologue to episode 264. A couple of reasons. First, I screwed up technically. I made a new Wirecast shot, split screen. And when you do that and you include a camera like this one that's got a microphone on it, Wirecast grabs that mic and sticks it in. And unless you manually turn it off, that audio pops up whenever you switch to that camera, and that's going to happen. And I have tediously gone through every shot and mitigated that as best I can, but you're still going to hear it. It's going to be in the background. Now, more than the background. It's pretty bad. So I needed to call your attention to that because you're going to hear it. You're going to say, what the heck? Second, the episode title, Change is Hard. Now, considering what's just happened with the Dayton Hamvention, and they're moving to the Greene County Fairgrounds in Xenia, Ohio, you're all going to think that that's what the episode is about. But this episode was actually recorded last Sunday. They'd announced that the Hera Arena was closing, but it wasn't until the day after Monday that they said where they were going. And, you know, we could have commented on the fact that they were going to have to move and made that part of the change is hard, but we didn't even think about it. It wasn't on our radar. What I'm talking about in the change is hard is all the digital voice stuff that has been in the past several programs. So it's going to be Jeff AC4ZO and Cyndi KD4ACW and me, just a BS session. It's way too long. There's really no reason for you to be watching or listening to this. Just skip on to the next one. I'll do the Dayton Hamvention episode in a day or three. Got some ideas for what I want to do for that. Different than what everybody else has been doing. And finally, I forgot to talk about Arvin and the Kickstarter and stuff at the beginning of that episode. So let's just go there for a moment. HamRadioNow.tv. Let's see where the Kickstarter is, because I want you to go to the Kickstarter for a contribution rather than Arvin for a contribution, because the Kickstarter's got a deadline. And once again, let's see how that's doing. August 21st is the deadline. And $5,000 is the goal. So go to hamradionow.tv, click right there on my nose, very carefully on my nose. And see that we've got 42 backers. We have $3,600 toward the $5,000 goal. I think it's been kind of still for a day or two, 16 days to go. And there's still two of those $500 corporate underwriter positions that are available. So if you know of a small ham radio company that you think would like to have their name associated, I'll do a short pitch for each one, 10, 15 seconds at the beginning of all the programs. It's about 21, 22 programs that they'll get their name mentioned on. In a very high profile, high status organization to be connected to, the Tapper and ARRL Digital Communications Conference. So it's a good deal. So if you know somebody, some company or small company, let them know this is available. Point them to the Kickstarter. And $500, it's not too bad for that kind of exposure. So that is it. Let us get to this episode. Like I say, it's already way too long. There's no reason for you to be here watching that, because it's just Jeff and Cyndi and me just kind of BSing about change on a variety of topics. If you like us guys, you'll watch and listen. If you're looking for a really substantial, meaty Ham Radio Now program with a lot of ham radio stuff in it, just wait for the next one or go back and watch a rerun. I've been vamping here for a while. You guys ready? No, it doesn't look like it. We're all fascinated by the news story of this guy that jumped from 29,000
about 5 miles.
No, they aren't going to show us. I bet you got to pay for it.
Yeah.
Well, of course.
If you want to see him land, you got to pay for it.
So we're on, by the way.
Oh, okay. We're just talking about technology.
Yeah. Look who's here. I'm starting out with the split screen so everybody can see. It's two of Ham Radio Now's audience's favorite people. It is on the right, ladies first, and And because she's my wife, Cyndi Pierce, KD4ACW.
Hi.
That's you, right?
That would be me, yes. Just in case you're wondering.
Yeah. And you can see the little title thing below. So actually, that won't come up yet. And on the left is Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
Yeah.
People keep saying it's been too long since you guys have been on. Cyndi, you were on the show vocally.
Yeah.
On the totally non-ham radio version.
From Europe.
Of course, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Jeff, you haven't been on in a long time.
No.
Jeff's been busy.
I haven't been worthy. Yeah.
I've got a lot of you to put on the show. Whenever I get around to editing the trip we took to Baltimore for Field Day in 2014 for the next big Field Day. Oh, you've got the bear. Can you pick up the bear?
Here. The bear hasn't been here in a while
yeah.
either.
See if you can pick up the bear.
Yeah, the bear's been having a really rough time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you'll be able to see. Yeah. Let me switch up Cindy's close-up.
Yeah.
You can see the bear has got it's not a fashion-forward collar.
No.
And he's got a tube.
Yeah.
Going right into his tummy.
He's doing very good with it.
Explain what that's all about.
Well, he's been sick now for quite a while, since about October, and they haven't quite figured out what's wrong with him, but he kind of took a turn for the worse. In the past 3 weeks, he's been on different types of chemo. And so in order to get him back up on his feet, we're having to feed him manually, which is pretty interesting, but it doesn't bother him at all. He seems to enjoy it.
Yeah.
So, but we've got a good set of doctors looking at him now. And so we're hoping
yeah,
so
I guess what basically is happening is his white blood cells are attacking his
red blood cells. Yeah. So his bone marrow is producing red blood cells, but something is killing them off. So, yeah. All right, I'm going to put you down, okay? But thank you for joining us.
This feeding tube is fairly new technology, I take it.
We haven't introduced the subject of the program yet.
Oh.
So,
back to that. Oops, yeah. Sorry, we jumped the gun on that one.
Yeah.
Bad job. We're just going to take over, okay?
Please, somebody needs to. It occurs to me that I've been making some very technology-forward programs lately, talking about products and projects that people are working on that could dictate or direct the course of ham radio as we know it on HF and on VHF-UHF, you know, talking about the digital mode stuff. And it occurs to me that I could possibly be scaring the hell out of everybody. Yeah. To paraphrase our current president, hams are clinging to their FM and sideband. Which we will pry away from their cold dead fingers.
Yeah.
Yeah, their FM handy talkies.
Yeah.
So I thought I would invite you guys over to talk about change and the difficulties therein. So I think this is BS number 5. I forget. And I was going to look it up, but I didn't. So this is Ham Radio Now, BS number, look at the screen there. It'll tell you what it is.
Okay.
And the title is Change is Hard. And sometimes stuff doesn't work right. So some of what we'll talk about is ham radio and some of it is not. I having been a ham for 51 and a half years.
Oh, scab.
I've seen
we know who's the oldest in the room, don't we?
Yeah. I've seen
some geezer in the corner over there. He's the guy that got me 10% discount over at Harris Teeter the other day.
Boy, that's nice.
5%, is that
yeah,
all?
Just 5.
That's he needs to start taking up going to Bojangles with me.
Oh, okay. These are special?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, and I got into the movie cheap, too. But I think you might, I mean, you crossed the 60 line. And a lot of places, their geezer discount kicks in at 60.
How much was your movie ticket?
$5.50.
I think mine was $6.50.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can't remember.
We went to see Star Trek 3.
And?
Good.
I'll be glad you weren't there.
Things blew up.
Oh, yeah.
Lots of noise. Okay.
It was a bad guy.
Okay, good.
We're good people.
Okay.
The
help in unexpected locations. And
okay.
Found betrayal in unexpected locations.
The reviews said that the movie was short on plot and long on action. And our reaction was,
That's what we want.
That's perfect. What they want to see. That's why I don't go when you all go to movies.
Yeah, perfect.
Because I don't need anything blowing up. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Plenty in the real world is blowing up and you try not to watch that.
That's all I need.
So things are in a continuous state of flux, and I thought we'd talk about some of the things that have changed across. I mean, you are both technology people. Cyndi, you've got an electrical engineering degree.
That's what it says. I can bring, want me to bring it in and show? In case there was any doubt.
We believe you.
He questions my authenticity sometimes.
Well, in practical matters, I think that my ham radio background is often more useful than your formal education.
The word is practical.
Yeah.
I got theoretical.
Yeah.
Out the yin yang for 4 years plus.
Yeah. And then you actually worked in engineering for a few years.
Yeah.
And then you discovered soft engineering.
Yeah.
Computers.
Yep.
And
system administration.
You took computer classes in college.
Back when there were punch cards, yes.
Yeah.
A little different. Now I'm dating myself, yes.
So it could have been, did they have computer science majors at that point?
Yes, but I didn't want to do that because I saw what they went through. They would carry around these big cardboard boxes full of cards, and the secret was is you had to take one of those big magic markers and draw a diagonal line across the deck. So if you accidentally dumped them, you could put them back in some reasonable order. But if you were smart, you always numbered your cards so that you could put them back in order easily. And they were sitting around in the data center all night long because in order to just do one compile of a program would take them all night to turn it around to see that you had a syntax error. And I was like, no. I'm not going to be doing that.
Do you remember the key punch machines, the confetti they made? It was the best confetti at the football game.
Yes. Or throwing out your window on the eighth story of a dorm. I never did that, but, you know, if you could. But, yes, it made wonderful confetti.
I'm trying to learn how to switch cameras here and do it properly, and I'm screwing up. Sometimes the person talking is on camera. Sometimes not. So then you went into computers, and you had a phenomenal career doing that.
Had. You sound
we'll see. I didn't
I'm
say
still
have.
Having
I said
a
have.
Good career.
I said have.
Okay. Yes.
Or have had.
Yes. It's technical. Yeah. I've been technical from
present and past tense.
Yeah.
And you have an advanced class ham radio license.
I do.
That's right.
Yeah. So you know that at one point I actually knew 13 words a minute.
Yeah. Jeff, you have a technical career.
Yeah.
And you share with me the exalted position of having a high school diploma.
Yeah. If my boss sees this, I'm going to have to answer some questions.
I don't think he's worried about that now. I think you've proven yourself plenty.
Yeah. So once again, lots of practical experience. Speaking of practical experience, I need to brag about something first. The other day you came to me, Cyndi, and related
about Pokemon?
We'll get to Pokemon in a minute. Because, oh man, did I have a Pokemon win today, didn't I?
You did. Yeah, we'll get to that in a minute. Okay,
but no, a couple days ago, you got an email. Was it a mailing list at work from somebody asking about resistors?
Oh, yeah, she wanted some resistors. There was a woman in technology meeting going on over at NetApp where I work. And she was obviously setting up some sort of demonstration. And she needed, what was it, a 23-ohm resistor or something?
No, 2.5-ohm.
Oh, 2.5-ohm resistor and some alligator clips. I'm like, I bet you we got some up here.
Yeah, so this is a company that is full of engineers and no small number of hams.
Yeah, that's true.
Mm-hmm. And so who had the resistor values that could do the job? Mr. Appliance Operator here. I mean, this is my resistor from the bin there. This
but
is my
to
resistor.
Show that you're old, you couldn't read the color code on there. You had to use an ohm meter code.
Well,
figure out what they were.
Bad boys bleep our young girls, but Violet gives willingly. But that just takes too long. It's much easier to look it up.
No. I knew the color code for years before I ever heard that.
Oh, really?
I never heard that I got into tech school.
Okay. Well, they didn't officially teach it in class, but, of course, classmates shared it. Yeah.
So they needed a 2.5-ohm resistor? Yeah. How many? Just one?
Yeah.
Yeah, which puts the gold band in an unusual place. It's okay. In this third position, second position. Third position.
It would only be a gold band if it was a 5%.
Well, no. In one of the earlier numbers, the gold is minus or divide by 10.
Okay.
You get 27 ohm and then a gold band for divide by 10.
Ah.
That's how they get those low values. Because they can't put a decimal point in anywhere. I'm the appliance operator, everybody. Anyway, I didn't have any 2.7 ohm resistors, but I had a bunch of 10 ohm resistors, and so 4 10 ohm resistors in parallel took us down to 2.5. Yeah. I don't know what they actually used, and I had a couple of other values that they could mix and match and put together. Did she say it worked?
I had to look.
Oh, the color code.
Yeah. You know, I haven't talked to her. I don't know.
Okay.
But that's a reminder I need to talk to her tomorrow.
If you know, with today's budget conscious companies, if they needed 2 2.5-ohm resistors and you sent the intern to get them, you probably would have come back with 1 5-ohm one saying it was cheaper.
Probably. Yeah. It could happen.
All right. So, where were we?
Do we want to go back to Pokemon, or are we still moving forward?
Oh, yeah, we can talk about the Pokemon now. Oh, man, did I score Pokemon points.
Yeah, and that was today, wasn't it?
Yeah. Now, Pokemon is another example of technology that is moving forward and causing people difficulties. But this, in this case, I believe it's deliberate. I think this is explained on Twit, my sort of the font of all knowledge for me. Well, Wikipedia and Twit, fonts of all knowledge. They don't have a instruction manual, a user manual for Pokemon, because it lets people discover things and then be the smart one in the group when they can tell everybody else.
Yeah,
that was me.
It's a huge social tool.
I've never played Pokemon.
I was going to ask if you're out chasing invisible monsters with your cell phone.
Cindy's the Pokemon player.
But he'll tag along now and then.
Yeah, and look over his shoulder. It's kind of cool.
Yeah, and if I'm driving, I'll hand him the phone so he can tap on the different locations.
You don't play Pokemon, right, Jeff?
No.
Okay, because otherwise we'd have to turn in our man cards.
That's right. It's okay for Cindy, but guys, we are not to play Pokemon. And if you don't know what it is, if you have a 6 or 7-year-old, they watch Pokemon cartoons on TV.
Yeah. I think I better go watch the cartoon because I don't know what it's all about.
Yeah.
I'm just doing the simple stuff.
I'm getting the
bear. But I'm at level 5, almost 6.
That's good? Well done. I'm proud of you.
There's a bear.
Feeding tube.
All right.
If I blow into this, what happens?
I come across the table and kill you.
I was thinking that we might do like a Macy's parade thing. The bear would go floating. And poor bear. He's been shaved so much, and his hair is not growing back right because of the anemia.
Yeah.
So, poor bear.
Yeah. But he's feeling good. He's up here socializing, so it's good.
Viewers know we lost the mouse in May, and we don't want to lose the bear. So we're going to try to hang on to him.
Okay.
I think I learned on Twit, although it could have been some other blog, that there's been a new release of Pokemon. They've upgraded or updated the program and changed some things, because as the kids are wont to do, damn kids.
Get off the lawn.
And we were at lunch, and there's a woman that works at the restaurant she's 20, and she's all excited about Pokemon.
She's at level 14, so I guess I'm not doing so good.
The ripe old age of 20, she's into Pokemon. Everybody is. Come on, everybody is.
Yeah.
And she was trying to show you how to
use and power up and I forget.
Gym. We were trying to learn how to fight in a gym.
It was the gym, but it also has to do with taking your Pokemon and doing something to them.
Oh, turning them in for candy or upgrading, evolving them,
Evolving them, maybe.
Jeff, I know all the terminology. Why is
that? Yeah, powering. That's evolve. Sad. Yeah,
that's because that's all they're talking about.
Or I can give them to the professor or whatever, but she was showing me how to do that, but she couldn't figure out where I would transfer, how I would transfer, because she...
Yeah, because they moved it. They moved the transfer button. And guess who knew where it was?
He knew they had a new
version. That was Bandit Bird. Bandit Bird.
Bandit Bird.
His name is really Pidget, but he...
Yeah.
He looks like he got a mask on.
See? Now I worry.
I have names for all of them.
Oh, okay.
Why is that?
Because I think they're funny.
Okay.
The names.
Turn in your man card.
I don't play that game.
So major points for me for Pokemon for a 20-year-old woman. Yeah. And from my wife.
We're both impressed, yeah.
How did you know that?
Yeah, because you don't play. Anyway, technology.
Yeah, people always accuse me of dominating the conversation, so I've got plenty to talk about. Let me let you guys start. Jeff, have you got an example of something in your life that has evolved?
Oh, yeah, I have examples of things that I was on the cutting edge of that improve with the passing of time, and that's most things. I have things that have improved with the passing of time according to popular opinion, but I'm clinging to the old ways because it works better. And I have things that have evolved with time that work better, and I cling to the old ways because I like it better.
Jeff knows how to use...
Where do we start?
He knows how to use a slide rule.
Oh, yeah.
That's impressive.
I should have brought one with me.
Oh, darn.
And I don't use that for practical purposes anymore. I only use the slide rule if I'm showing off.
You aren't in the Target looking at how much toilet paper is by the roll with your slide rule.
You could calculate. Well, this could go down the hill. It's not Friday night now.
Okay. So. Okay, I'll be quiet.
So where do we start?
Give me an example of some piece of technology that... Let's go with electronic technology first, because I understand you have some totally analog technology. You know, that's a misuse of the word analog.
Well, it's not electronic technology. This might be a good place to start.
All right.
GPSs.
Here's your... GPSs. Close-up.
Whoa. It's not, okay. It'll be up in a minute. But, you know, in the early days of GPS, they were not navigational tools for driving directions and stuff like that. They were just handheld devices that could, you know, lock onto the satellites and give a calculation and tell you where you're here. You call them, by the best description I've ever heard, the ultimate "you are here" machine.
Yeah.
And it could give your speed, you know, and it could kind of show where you were going, and they could do dead reckoning if they lost the signal.
You turn it on and a giant red X appears beneath your feet.
Say, here you are. So they had limited usefulness, but people still found ways to do interesting things with them. But it was only a matter of time, and not very much time, before they found their way into being useful navigational tools for automobiles. And I have with me the first one I had that was specifically for navigation. This is a Street Pilot 3. And it's from around, I guess, about 12 or 14 years ago. It's got a little visor on it because I always used it on a motorcycle. And you could never see the screen on the motorcycle if the sun was shining on it. But the little plastic visor made out of a kid's report cover fixed that. But as a navigation tool, it worked okay once it was running, but it was terrible to program. If you used a map, you know, we were all using Street Atlas at the time, and trying to make a route on a PC and download it to this device was terrible. And today's navigational GPSs, while they work thousands of times better than this one did and have lots of interesting features, I don't know that it's even possible to do a route on a PC now and download it, but the user interface is so simple on today's modern automotive GPSs that I just plot routes right on it. Now, I haven't missed doing it on the computer at all. It's been fun. It's been fine. So there's an improvement in technology that, you know, like you would expect, has really improved and made life better for people.
I have one of the predecessors to that, the Garmin GPS 3. I think you had one of those.
I've got the eTrex Lengen and then a PN30 that I got later on. I got the PN30 because it has some applications in it that's specific for geocaching, something I was doing a lot of at that time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think a lot of those early GPSs that didn't have maps or didn't have serious maps, because the GPS 3 had, you know, Garmin 3 had a map sort of in it.
Yeah, it was 50K.
Yeah. That I think people use them not so much for driving navigation, but hiking, hiking and boating and things like that.
Exactly.
Yeah. We used one walking across the lava fields in Hawaii.
Yeah. Marked the spot where your body was going to be. That's a whole nother story. I have to get my license for that one.
Yeah. Well, but it was...
that story was told, wasn't it? I saw a video of it, but I don't know if it's on an episode.
It's not. It's not online anymore.
He fell in a lava field, and it was ugly.
But that wasn't the one we were marking, because that was only a mile and a half or 2 mile walk. One visit. It took 6 miles.
That was our first one where you fell.
Yeah, 6 miles from the point where the lava covered the road, and you couldn't drive any farther, out to where the lava was actually flowing across. More lava, older lava, and we wanted to get out that far. But for the first half a mile or so, the rangers had put signposts, and then nothing. You're on your own.
Yeah.
And this was as far as the eye could see. No reference to anything except
water.
Yeah. But you couldn't. You could sort of see where the water was, and you could see where the mountains were. So you got your general orientation, but
nothing in between.
Yeah.
That was the. And GPS
then the
3,
sun
right?
went down, and there was nothing, period.
Yeah.
So I would mark positions on the GPS 3 and then turn it off because the batteries weren't going to last for 6 hours.
Yeah.
So, but I wanted to mark where things were.
Yeah, we didn't have smartphones back then.
The GPS 3 would do something that nothing that I've got now that I've been able to find, including the smartest technology in my smartphone, would be able to do. I could put in waypoints and show five or six of them on the screen at one time with the direction and distance from where I currently was to this thing. Not driving directions, and I didn't want driving directions. I wanted line of sight distance, and what I used it for was putting repeaters in there so I'd know how far I was from the repeater. Because you're always thinking, I got to be 80 miles from this repeater, and I'm still keying it up with a handy-talky. And I look at the GPS, and I'm 25. But it was helpful and impressive on the big repeaters around here, the ones that are up on the 2,000-foot towers, because you would get 60, 70 miles away and see that you're still in range of the repeater, and that was pretty cool.
Yeah.
So
there's been a lot of improvement in them, but there's some features that have just fallen by the wayside if they weren't popular. You know, popularity determines the direction that products go. Yeah.
There might be an app that somebody's made, but I've done a fair amount of searching that I don't want to see the map. I want to see a four or five waypoints across my screen and my current bearing and distance. And that's all I want.
I have two GPS apps on my phone, but neither one can do, waypoints or anything. They're just how high you are, how fast you're going. Mm-hmm. Well, I use them in airplanes. Because the GPS still works in airplanes mode. Yeah. Do you remember the time we were flying somewhere and I almost got the GPS does. I almost got your GPS 3 taken away on a plane.
I don't remember that. I do remember showing the thing to pilots who were fascinated.
We may have been coming back from Salina, Kansas when that happened one time. Or Chicago or something.
What happened?
I
was just using, I had the window seat. Mm-hmm. You were in the... I think you were in a seat maybe behind me, and I was just holding it up to the window, looking at where we were going, and a flight attendant came by. There were rules on what PEDs you're allowed to have, but that wasn't covered in it then.
Yeah, because they were too new. The problem that I had, because everyone was fascinated by it, especially at altitude, because they didn't have those things. And we're here? See the red X down there?
Well, now it plot on the street atlas map where we were.
And the mistake that I made, because no one was having a problem with it, until they said, well, what is this? It's a GPS receiver.
The word receiver.
Bing.
Yeah.
Yeah, receivers can't have receivers.
Yeah.
Then. Great Dilbert cartoon. Remember, yeah. Remember the Dilbert? The boss is on the plane. He's pecking at his computer and the plane crashes.
I don't think I saw that one.
Yeah. That's a classic.
You know who reads the comics every day.
Oh, yeah.
That we can tell now.
Modern technology. I read the comics. Well, I read the newspaper on a tablet, and I download the PDF of it. I would be happy to read their app, the News and Observer here in Raleigh. I'd be happy to read the newspaper on their app. It would actually be more convenient because the PDF I'm looking at is a replica of the physical paper, which means the story goes for a couple of paragraphs and then jumps to 30 pages down. Yeah, well, I'm used to that because I'm old, but
we can handle it.
It would be okay to read it just on the app, but the app doesn't have the comics. Nothing but the printed paper and the PDF version of the printed paper has the comics. Now, I could probably figure out how to put a list together of not only the comics that are in the current paper, but lots of other comics that have gone by the wayside. They're all online. You could look at them. I am lazier than that. But I like the idea of sitting at the subway typically and flicking through the tablet and no longer having this paper spread out across my table, knocking over my drink, people trying to get by me in the aisle. Works great. But
you do lose the personal space buffer, though.
Well, yeah. But I've been emailing somebody at the paper because about a third of the comics are bad resolution. They're fuzzy. And two-thirds are fine. And I used to do this when I did magazines and stuff, figuring out the best way to take art and get it into a magazine so that it wasn't a real huge file, but still good and sharp. And I learned the techniques for doing that. And they're screwing things up at the paper. Some of it is hard enough to read. You can't really read the dialogue very well. And there's a woman at the paper that absolutely thinks I'm an idiot. Because I'll write to them about once a week or so. I say, well, you got Dilbert fixed, but you screwed up rhymes with orange. I'm pretty sure that whoever's doing it, whoever's copying the comics out of wherever they get them and into the paper, is the lowest paid intern on the staff, one notch below the person that writes the obituaries.
Ooh, that's low.
That is low. Yeah. So, Cyndi?
Technology?
Yeah.
Oh, the one that I think about the most really is just the internet in general. I'll go back.
Oh, yeah, it's totally broken.
Well, not that it's broken, but it's just, I'm glad that I've been able to see it since the beginning of time, so to speak. Because, we always talk about in the days, I had like a VT100.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and the acoustically coupled 300 baud modem. You have to dial it up and put it into the cradle and, listen to all that going on. And we were just, thrilled as, the speed kept up going up and up. But it's just, you think, well, how much faster can it get? And it just keeps getting faster. That's been a lot of fun to watch. And then, of course, being in technology, thinking about storage and how, it used to all go on to tape, or it used to be actually paper tape was a method of storing, punching the paper tape. And then they went to magnetic tape. Okay. And then, of course, the spinning disk drives. I was thrilled when I had a 500 megabyte disk drive for my VAX 780. Once again, dating myself. Things the size of a washing machine. And had 580 megabytes. And then we really went uptown when we got one that was 750.
That was a disc pack, I take it?
The disc pack was the 500. The first one that was not was the 750, this RPO7, I think it was.
Oh, my goodness.
RMO5 was the 500 megabyte. And that was, so you did backups once a month. We'd go into the data center, bring everything down. And so we had these other packs, old ones, that we could overwrite. So what we'd do is we'd select two drives. We'd leave, the original one sitting its original drive, and then we'd take the other one out, put the blank one in, and do a copy over. And then what you do, as I learned, is you always took the one you made a copy to, make that your production drive, because that was the best way to test whether you had done a good backup or not, right? Thank you, Rodney Wines.
The backups were stored off-site because they're physical backups, right?
Well, you know, back then.
Or you were lucky.
Or you were just lucky. And we would just storm across the room in a shelf. But yes, technically speaking, as we got more sophisticated and concerned about those things, and regulations started to dictate how you would do that, is yes, you would have to put it off site. And, you know, all up through my, when I worked for Wachovia as a storage admin, we had, you know, sites that would actually, you know, cross copy things, and it kept it up to date, you know, all the way up to the last bit written, which was really amazing. I mean, like I said, it's just nice to have been around from the early days and see it evolve, and, you know, things you never thought you were going to ever see in your lifetime, there they are.
So do you have an example of something that evolved and in theory was going to get better, mm-hmm. but in reality, at least for a while, got worse?
Got worse.
Doesn't that always happen?
Well, actually, networking did that.
Okay.
The first means of connecting PCs together was with the thin net, remember?
Yep.
And then and the other coax-based nets. Mm-hmm. And then when the UTP came along, all the network philosophies, you know, the token ring and all these other things.
Yeah, it had to, yeah, the networking, the underlying protocols and such had to kind of work their way out. And the ones that really didn't work that well, you just tossed aside.
Fell by the wayside.
Yeah, token ring. I haven't heard that one in a long time. You know, bus and tag, which I believe is probably still, hey, Bear. Is still in use, but yeah, it's just amazing in my, just in my career lifetime. You know, I started working in 1982, and to think where we've come since then, it's just amazing. And, you know, what's going to come in the next 10, 20 years, I really look forward to it.
So the reason I'm going that direction is we've been looking at some things that some folks have been proposing from Wireless Holdings and from Algorand, the Katana, things that you guys don't know what I'm talking about because you don't watch the show.
Katana's a motorcycle to me.
Okay. Yeah. I don't watch the whole show. I just hear
Katana, like antenna, Katana.
Oh, Cantana.
That's a dummy load.
Right.
Yeah, I knew that.
No, Katana is Bruce Perrin's, the white box, or what they were referring to as, have we got the right thing going here? Yeah. HT of the future. It was echo. You guys didn't hear it. that the Wireless Holdings, DV4 Mobile, these things will be digital radios that did all of the digital modes as opposed to picking one walled garden, things like that. And what I was thinking of is, you know, we're talking about and done several programs on these, a lot with Bruce, and the first one, the last show with Uri, who I kept saying Yuri or Ivan, from Wireless Holdings. And it occurred to me that I never challenged them with whether these things were going to work once they were first put out. I'm sure they want them to work, and they'll put in all the engineering they can, but these are small companies or just individuals. And the first time we get our hands on one, it's probably going to be buggy. Probably not going to work all that.
I mean, radios from the big three can be buggy.
Sure, sure. Case in point. My turn to go back in history, and I'm afraid I've got a lot of it here. So,
are we supposed to take a break?
Hey, what you should do is jump in and comment if you can, because this is going back long before either of you guys were hams. And as I look over here on my computer screen, I realize that I failed to mention that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. And not only is it brought to you by you, but we are running this Kickstarter. So stop by hamradionow.tv and click to enter. And this time, don't go down to the bottom and click on Arvin, which would be normally your route to be able to make a contribution to help keep us on the air. But come up here to the top, and you got to center right on my nose there. No, no, you don't.
There's punch him in the nose.
Yeah, punch me in the nose. There's links all over the place. Let's get you to the Kickstarter. The Kickstarter is to get us to the Tapper Conference, the Digital Communications Conference, coming up in September in St. Petersburg, Florida. And it is, the Kickstarter is for doing the video. It's not for funding the conference at all. It's purely for doing the video. It will expire on August 21st, and the goal is $5,000. And we are currently at $3,525, a little over $3,500, 21 days to go. So, guys, we're doing pretty well.
It looks like you're going.
I think this is going to happen. So happy about that. HamRadioNow.tv and click on my nose and take you to the Kickstarter. It's an easy way to get to. The actual address for the Kickstarter is this thing up here, and you can type all that in if you want. I'm not even going to read it out, but the easy way is through HamRadioNow.tv. So that's the pitch. And so I was going to now look at some other things that are here. This was the first handheld 2-meter radio that I ever had.
Holy cow.
It is from Pi, which is a British company. And it had three channels. These are the channel selector, volume and squelch, and on, off, and something I can't read. I don't really remember what it was. And I had this back in about 1970, 71, something like that. And carried it around every place. Carried it to school, carried it to my part-time jobs, things like that. It was crystalled up for a local repeater in Chicago and 9-4 simplex. And I'm not sure what I had in the third channel. But crystalled up are the words that I wanted to say, because the frequency was determined by crystals. I don't have a crystal to show.
Really? Oh, in yeah. all of this, you don't have a crystal.
And all of that crap that you see around Jeff and Cyndi there, and far beyond
more, me. A lot more you can't see from the camera.
It's hard to believe.
I don't have a crystal. There are some crystals in things, but I'm not going to take them all apart to be able to do it. But back in the day, crystals were what we used to determine frequency. This radio was absolutely my pride and joy. At the time, it's an icon, right? It's a Motorola HT220. The plate came off that says Motorola, and I'd lost it someplace. Four channels, and crystal controlled. Back in the day, that was what we used for frequencies. In the early days of 2-meter FM, that was okay. Cindy's playing with the bear there.
Sorry. He's tickling my leg with his whiskers.
He's getting whiskers back.
Yeah.
Yeah. He had lost his whiskers for a while. And they're growing back. So back in the day, Jeff, crystals were what we had. Now you remember crystal control.
Yeah, my first CB was a 6-channel crystal control. I only had 2 channels in it, and I couldn't afford crystals for the other channels. But they were available walking distance from my house.
Buying them from a Radio Shack?
It was called Harco Electronics, and that's where I got all my components. Very first transistor I ever bought was from there.
Long gone.
Tools and stuff.
Yeah. So crystals were the frequency determining element. And back in the very early days, the novices were required to use a crystal. The HF rigs used VFOs, variable frequency oscillator, which was a combination of mostly capacitor, a variable capacitor, air variable. I don't have an example of that either, but you had a fixed plate. Pretend this is a piece of metal. Pretend this is another piece of metal. This is an actual piece of metal. And you would tune the tuning dial, and it would slide them back and forth, and that would determine the frequency. And with varying levels of precision, depending on the technology that all went behind it. But in the radios that I was using back in the day, that with VFOs, the calibration was not very good. And you could not determine your frequency closer than, at best, a kilohertz. And with many of the earlier radios, if you were within 5 kilohertz, you were doing well. There'd be a crystal in the radio for a calibrator, a crystal calibrator in the receiver. And tune in that, and it would be probably plus or minus a couple of hundred cycles. Because we called them cycles back then, not hertz. And you'd adjust your dial so the little line in your dial would line up properly. And you went and tuned. And
slide rule dials, they were called.
Some slide rule and some half moon type. You know, so those were the frequency determining elements on HF. And the crystals were the frequency determining elements on VHF, FM. Not so much on AM. And on sideband VFOs, the sideband, a little bit of sideband that was up in the 2 meter band. And I'm talking, I got licensed in 1965. So this is for the next 4 or 5 years, from 1965 to 1970. And that was the birth of FM as it appeared in amateur radio. The birth of FM as it appeared in public safety started a decade or more before that with Motorola and GE and RCA. Some fairly rudimentary stuff, but it was, again, all crystal controlled.
To many, it heralded the end of amateur radio.
As we know it. Yeah. The HF hams looked at us VHF FM operators with crystal controlled, not just crystal controlled transmitters, because crystal controlled transmitter, they could sort of understand. Because novices use that. And some of the VHF radios, 2 and 6 meters, use crystal controls because the VFO is an expensive outboard accessory. So a lot of radios still use crystals on VHF, but not for receive. So here we were with our FM radios, crystal transmit, crystal receive. What did that remind you of?
Well, channelized CB.
CB. We're a bunch of CBers.
Yeah.
Police departments were channelized, taxi cabs, fire departments, ambulances, EMS, all of that. But who did we get equated to? And we were using the radios that came out of those old services. Who did we get equated to? Ah, you bunch of FMC beers.
Yeah.
I love hams. Hams are just some of my favorite people. Find a mud puddle and stick your head in.
So in 1970, to be geeky, you had to also be strong. Those didn't look light.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, all full of tubes. And, yep.
You could quit weightlifting once you got this unit here.
Mm-hmm. That's true. This this was light, relatively, and easy to carry around and crystal controlled. What have I got next here? This was my next pride and joy. It came long before the HT220. It is from a company called Standard. And Standard, they've got a storied history. They've been part of Yaesu a little bit. Some of Yaesu's technology came from their acquisition of Standard. So Standard doesn't exist as a standalone company. They made commercial radios and stuff, but every once in a while they would dabble in amateur equipment. And this was one of their first. It was a 5-channel.
Like that
crystal controlled radio.
Yeah, world's smallest handy rig.
Yeah, it was pretty big, but it was also crystal controlled. And Jeff, you had mentioned that
1 watt.
Yeah.
Wow.
I think it actually did 2 watts. Mm-hmm. You had mentioned that part of the problem why you didn't fully crystal your 6-channel radio was it was expensive.
Yeah, the synthesizer hadn't come along yet, so radios didn't come with those.
Don't say the S word yet. I'm holding that back.
They didn't come with crystals. You had to buy them if you wanted them, and yeah. I was a kid.
Yeah, and they could be, probably the cheapest was about $5 a crystal, $10 a channel, because you need one for transmit, one for receive. So hams contorted themselves in all kinds of ways to try to get around the expense of these crystals. So a 5-channel radio, this radio probably cost a couple hundred bucks. But add 5 channels worth of crystals, and it added another $100. Easy. This radio drove hams to distraction. The ICOM IC22 is one of the nicest crystal-controlled and one of the last crystal-controlled 2-meter radios to come on the market. This sucker had 22 channels, 44 crystals to buy if you're going to fill the thing up. At best, at, you know, $10 a channel. So you doubled the price of the radio or more by filling it up with crystals. Not very many people put in 22 channels worth.
I wouldn't think so.
Nope.
Man.
I think I've got some video of a guy actually playing with 22. Still working. This is ICOM's next attempt at quelling the masses from their complaints about the expense of crystal control radios. And this is ICOM's first synthesized radio, sort of synthesized. No crystals, diodes. They still called it the 22, but they called it the 22S. And the S would be for sort of synthesized. And let's see if I can get the big picture here. This board here, let me get myself off of the screen. This board here was a diode matrix. And depending on how you plugged in jumpers, you set the frequency that each channel was going to operate on without having to buy a crystal. The radio itself, I think, was fairly expensive.
Were there crystals in the radio? Normally a synthesizer is a group of crystals and you switch them. You know, their functionality is switched in and out on various combinations of crystals to synthesize the various frequencies. My first synthesizer used, I think it was 12 crystals.
Well, there is a crystal or two in there. I don't think that they use multiple crystals. And I wasn't aware that most synthesizers require multiple crystals. I certainly don't
today. My first one, it came with all of them, but it was a Lafayette Comstat 25B.
Another CB radio.
Yeah.
Were you a CB-er?
Yeah. So was I. But it was 23 channels.
Cyndi, were you ever a CB-er?
Yeah.
Did you have a handle?
I did.
What was it?
White Lark.
Aw. Because you had a white...
You were Skylark. Yeah. That was in the
80s. Yeah. So you were driving, so you weren't the seat cover.
I was driving, so I was.
So you weren't the seat cover. Okay. Seat cover is the passenger, female passenger. Hey, you guys.
Hey.
Hi. We're back.
Recovering from a massive failure. Speaking of technology, one of the things that I was actually going to talk about being not as good as it ought to be is this Wirecast system that I'm using here. It's over here. Can't really see it very well. It's got some bugs, but we'll save that for later if we actually have a later.
Do you get updates for that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I actually just spent like $600 updating it to its new version. Oh. So that's where your money goes to. What happened was I screwed up and I was recording to the wrong hard drive. And I tell it what hard drive to go to, and it's supposed to stay there, but it changes it once in a while. And we filled up a hard drive and it went blip. I've done that a time or two before. I did it at Tapper one time. Yeah. so we had,
yeah, tired of us.
We were at the seat cover story.
Yes, we were, weren't we?
Yeah. So we didn't learn Jeff's CB handle.
Oh yeah.
So you crossed over from call signs and names to handle territory.
Well, when I quit using the CB, we still were required to use a license, but I wasn't KEX3476 by then. Bobby and I had gotten married in 1974 and moved to a different household, needed a different CB license, and that license came, and it was a 4x4, and I can't remember what it was, but it was four letters followed by four digits, and then sometime after that, licenses were no longer issued.
Yeah, I got a CB license of my own at some point. The KLJ7361 was my dad's, because he had to be 18, and I was not 18 yet.
Same.
Yeah, and I don't remember the numbers. I remember the prefix, K-A-R-H. Something.
Oh, you had a 4x4 as well.
Yeah. Yeah. And again, before they all disappeared. I still got to open a file cabinet over there someplace.
So you never had a handle?
Never had a handle in the days when the Smokey and the Bandit stuff.
We need to give him one.
Well, I do. I do now. I mean, when I you know, my car.
That was a kill cycle car.
That's a good one. No, when I, if I need to use a handle, I'm the porcupine.
Yeah, that's right.
That's true. Yeah, you are.
You bet. So, let's continue down the memory lane here. Hams went to really great lengths to try to figure out how to put more frequencies in the radio without spending all that money on crystals. So we saw the IC22. The radio I'm going to show you now, I think, might have predated the IC22. It is, and old-time hams are going to remember this one. And this radio is a great example of what I'm talking about, of advances, theoretically advances in technology that just went the wrong direction. The FM27B. It didn't have any crystals in it, but it was one of the first radios that would do the whole band, every frequency. You remember what technology, Jeff, we had that would allow you to use a whole band on every frequency back then and even long before?
To do what?
To be able to operate on any frequency in the band. I mean, we weren't hams.
Oh, Spark.
Not all at once.
Oh. You asked.
No, I mean, hams were able to operate at will on any frequency within the band, on AM or sideband or CW, on the HF bands, and on 2 meters to some extent. What was that technology?
Well, just with the crystal, as long as you had the crystal for the frequency you wanted.
Well, no.
You're asking a leading question, but he thinks I'm smart.
I was discussing this technology at the very beginning of the program. You grabbed a knob and you turned
VFO.
The VFO, yes. With that, remember the meshing, all that stuff. Well, this radio used VFOs. What a concept. Why didn't anyone think of that before? Because it didn't work.
And there we have it.
That's a pretty good reason.
Well, I mean, it worked in that you could get to the frequency that you wanted, but the...
Yeah, how accurately, though? How close dare you get to a band edge before you're in trouble?
Well, you could always tell on a repeater when somebody was using an FM27B.
Because they sounded like this!
They were off frequency. They were never right on frequency. And if they started right on frequency, it drifted off, and within a few minutes, it was no longer on frequency anymore. And it had no mechanism for, I don't think, hit for making sure that you got right on frequency. Because you couldn't spot your transmitter to your receiver frequency. Remember that terminology?
Yeah.
You ever hear of spotters? You couldn't, because the repeater, you were transmitting on a different frequency to the repeater. I think the 27B may have had, let me look carefully at this dial. Pulled a spot. Okay, it's had some kind of a spot capability, but I don't know if that would set your offset. But in any case, you could always tell because somebody was off frequency.
So these knobs were continuous. They didn't have detents in them, right?
Right.
What's interesting about them is they're more than 180 degrees because air variable capacitors, as far as I know, were 180 degrees unless there was no stop at all. And then they would just go continuously around. And those knobs don't look sophisticated enough to be vernier of any sort. So I'm wondering what they were turning. I'm betting it was not an air variable capacitor.
No, I don't think it was.
They're,
I think,
270
that they used,
degrees or so.
Yeah, they might have. It might have been, what is the term? Oops, permeability tuned. Tuning a...
So an inductive slug.
Maybe.
Inductor?
Yeah, I'd have to go look. And,
boy, that would really be not very accurate, though, wouldn't it?
I'd have to go look up. I'm an appliance operator. I'm a caveman.
Yeah, we know that.
So, and I had the wrong picture up there for a while. Sorry. So I don't remember exactly what they did, but it wasn't crystals and it wasn't really a synthesizer. I got somebody playing with one though. I got some video here.
WM3PEN.
You could tune in the receiver just fine.
Repeater.
I don't know how well you guys were hearing that. I just got some bleed speakers on here.
The 5,000 watt version of the antenna. When the guy said, I said, forget it.
Yeah, okay. So that was somebody actually making one run.
Sounded pretty good.
Well, of course, you receive. You could tune in just fine. It was setting your transmitter to get through the repeater, which was always difficult. What have I got next? Here is an example of a major company, ICOM, going absolutely the wrong direction.
Okay.
And everyone who was back from that era is going to recognize this. It was an extremely popular radio. In the era of the FM27B, this radio was true crystal controlled, but it was also synthesized. They used what they called a crystal plexer, and that is what I'm thinking that you had with your 12 or 13 crystals making a bunch of other frequencies. Because this thing had, I don't know, a dozen crystals in it, but it would make sort of every frequency. And by sort of, here was the problem. At the time this radio was developed, the 2 meter band for repeaters ran from 146 to 148. There were 67 channels in 30 kilohertz steps. Just after this radio was released, we ran out of room. We frequency coordinators ran out of room on the 2 meter band for repeaters. And two things happened. We split the 30 kilohertz channels in half to 15 kilohertz. Bad idea. Bad idea then. Bad idea now. And other parts of the country, like most of the West, abandoned that quickly and said, bad idea. And the FCC opened up the bottom part of the band, 144.5 to 145.5, to repeaters. They had, at some point, in the early days, there were no limits where repeaters could be. And most of the 2 meter band was vacant. A fallow territory. Then repeaters came along and started filling things up. And the old codger said, we got to stop this. It's too good a thing. So they convinced the FCC to limit the repeaters to the top 2 megahertz of the band and keep the bottom half for the real hams. Well, repeaters took over everything. And so then they got part of the bottom part. We saved a little bit at the very bottom for sideband CW, esoteric modes. We saved a little bit in the middle for satellites and stuff. But we added that spot at the bottom. And having had a bad experience with 15 kilohertz channels, we said, let's do the right thing. We'll do 20 kilohertz channels in this territory where everything is going to be all brand new. The poor old IC230 was stuck in the top 2 megahertz and 30 kilohertz channels. They still sold them for a while. As I was researching this, somebody was saying that they got one anyway because at least it got on some channels and they could afford it.
Well, half the channels, and I would imagine the repeaters were all sent at the time. The repeaters were all sent on those frequencies,
yeah.
Right?
It was only the new ones coming along that went on to the 15 kilohertz.
Most hams, you know, have no regard for the new. Well, don't care about it.
That's what this whole show is about.
Right.
So, but it was the sort of the leading edge of the frequency synthesizer. And then, let's see. This radio was one of my pride and joys. This radio came out shortly after the IC230. It was from Midland, which had a big reputation in CB, but had never had a big reputation in ham radio. And it covered the whole band in 5 kilohertz steps. The tuning was a little bit awkward. Let me see if I can. There's some video, I think, of somebody actually doing it. But with this button, you switched which megahertz you were going to be in. With this button, you switched which offset, plus or minus. And the A and B, you could stick in a crystal to give you an odd offset if you still had one of those old repeaters. Because a few were legacy repeaters, didn't switch to 600 kilohertz when everybody else does. Volume and squelch over there. Power, low and high power. The on-off button was actually a click when you turn on. Remember when you click in a volume control and something turns on?
Yeah.
And then with this two concentric knobs, one would tune the 100 kilohertz and one would tune the 10 kilohertz. And no scanner in it. Yeah, we didn't have memories back in those days. I wore out those knobs on mine just manually scanning across the band looking for activity on all the various repeaters, because I wanted to know who was on and, you know, what people were doing. Snoopy even back then. So that radio was a holy grail for me. Here's another pride and joy. This this radio came along about the same time that one did. And let me show you the close-up. This is the Tempo S1. It's a 2-meter synthesized handheld. A little bit more elegant in tuning capability as it had the thumb wheel switches. So cover the whole band, 144, 145, 6, and 7. And to get the 5 kilohertz offset, just that button there. And then this switch to go minus, plus minus, or simplex. So this was an awesome radio. It was 5 watts. This radio had the best sounding audio of any 2-meter FM transmitter I've ever heard. Very good, full fidelity, full range. Awesome audio. Ever since then, everyone's screwed it up because they think, I think we need communications quality because we're trying to work DX. This is great. Its problems were that the battery was inside. It was possible to take out the screws and you could get another battery and change it, but your battery changing was not fast. This was the connector to plug it in. And if you talked very much, you had an hour or so of useful time and then 12 hours of charging. So, but every frequency, no tone, no PL. It did have an earphone and an external antenna jack. It didn't have an external microphone, but you could plug in an external antenna and use it in your car for until the battery died. And this was just for charging this this connector on the back.
You couldn't operate couldn't plug from in.
It didn't. Mm. It wasn't
so 12. No life support.
Yeah.
No radio and life support. These all predate you guys because these were now where you're in the mid to two-thirds of the way through the 70s, 76, 77 territory. There's my next one. Another pride and joy. This radio from ICOM it's very similar, thumb wheel switches. Oh, that's cool.
Whoa.
Thumb wheel switches for frequency. It did have a speaker mic connection in the same configuration as almost every ICOM handy talkie has been able to do ever since then, except for the IC92 D-Star handy talkie. It wouldn't do that. They needed that grotesque
$300
GPS speaker mic. And then on the back, the offset. Low and high power. It was 1 watt or, depending on what size battery you put on it, up to 5 watts, but a long life battery, 2.5 watts, simplex and duplex plus and minus. This thing here was an add-on. This was to be able to put PL tones in it. Here is its big advantage. And let's see if I can actually do it. Oh, good. Take off the battery.
Replaceable battery.
Yeah. In the early days, NiCad, this was an aftermarket, this Mr. NiCad. And all of my NiCad batteries are totally dead. I can't turn this on, make it play, but the replaceable battery and ICOM quality compared to the Tempo one, it worked pretty well. It was fine as a radio, but his battery was its big limitation. And I guess that's all the pictures that I've got, but I got one more radio. Well, that is where I left things. And radios like this, again, no memories, wore out the thumb wheel switches, scanning the band, looking for activity, trying to find out, being nosy, wanting to know everything everybody was doing, and loved this radio. Still have it. Not quite as much as I love my wife, Cyndi.
But that was the right answer.
I love this radio.
Just in time, too.
Yeah. I took a 10-year sabbatical from ham radio. In 1980, 1979, 1980, my life went to hell. I got addicted to drugs. I got divorced. My career took off in video editing.
Everything else went
down
the tubes.
Doing great, but everything else went down the tubes. I ran screaming from the radio club that I was the president of at age 29 and the Hamfest that I was the chairman of. All too much. Go away. Leave me alone. Go away. And concentrated on her work for a while. The drugs got worse. I ran screaming from Chicago in 1986 and got cleaned up. Different story for a different time. Ended up here in North Carolina in 1990. Didn't know a soul. Came here because my dad had retired here. Wanted to be close. Didn't know anybody. Had been out of ham radio for 10 years. Still had this. Charged the battery up, put on a local repeater, found some hams, got into the local radio club. I have been very careful in the 26 years since. I was just going to say, I've been very careful not to let it get over my head again. Well, that's clearly stupid.
Nice try.
But I have picked what it is that I want to do. And if I don't want to do it, I say no. And I got into a couple things because people thought they really needed me to. And I did them for a couple of years and then bailed out. One of them was the Repeater Journal magazine. I edited that because the guy that had edited it before, Wayne Williams, K4MOB, very famous call sign in the Southeast, had cancer. He was dying. And he needed somebody who could step right in and take over. And I had the skills. The journalism and the technical magazine producing skills. So I did that, but I didn't like doing it. And I wanted to do this TV show, so that's what I've done. And so here I am.
You know, neither one of us liked when he was doing the Repeater Journal either.
No.
He did a wonderful
job. I'm glad he was able to help Wayne, but yeah, that was very, very time consuming.
We didn't have much radio play time during that time.
I was a little obsessed.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was quarterly. So for a couple of weeks,
for maybe 1 or 2 weeks, you didn't have to worry about it, but it was constant, yeah.
Yeah. I've kind of blocked that out from my mind. But when I got here, things had progressed. People weren't dialing things with thumb wheel switches anymore. Processors had gotten cheap enough and powerful enough that simple processors, or maybe complex processors, but early days processors, appeared in radios. And so sometime in that decade that I was gone, radios developed memory. I'm not sure what happened to me because I've never developed one. But radio started to develop memory. And simple at first. And we're coming into the era that you guys have seen. You had a KDK. Mm-hmm. It had 4 channels of memory or something. Your dad gave it to you. Yeah. And what was your first 2-meter radio?
It was some Kenwood. I bought at the Ham Fest down in Sanford, and if I remember right, it had 9 channels. It might have been 10, but one was reserved for some use. I think it had 9 usable memory channels.
Yeah, and then my first mobile radio when I got back into the deal was an Elenco. It's still sitting on the shelf, a DR590. It had like 20 channels, and it was okay. It was a little strange, but it was okay. But I can't really complain that it's programming, and that's another thing that we had. These things, there was no programming. Anybody could pick one.
What you want.
Anybody could pick one of these up and use it, because you dial the frequency, you set the offset. Yeah, you know, those things you had to learn, but that's 30 seconds worth of instructions. Anybody could do that. No more. Not even now. You can't pick up some of the radios I've got and get them on the air and use them where you want. You might be able to use them where I left them. So this was my next real serious acquisition. This is an ICOM 2410. 20 channels, dual band, VHF and UHF, although you could only put VHF frequencies on the left side and UHF on the right. You could allocate how many you wanted to for both. And it would do crossband repeat. It would do crossband repeat so cool that I killed the UHF transmitter by accidentally leaving it in high power on UHF, and the squelch opened up on VHF and burned out the transistors. So UHF XMIT dead. As far as I know, the radio would still work. I could power it up and make it go. This had one of the best receivers going. Very intermod resistant. And people have always said that you can't have a barn door receiver, something that receives outside the ham band, and be intermod resistant. They say guaranteed, if you can receive up into the public safety band, your intermod's going to be bad. This radio hears it all over the place, and pretty intermod resistant. For some reason, ICOM forgot how they did that. Next series of radios they had, including the 2820 that I've got, it's not very good in terms of intermod. So we had in that period, that radio actually was 90s. This radio is an example of something that appeared in the mid to late 80s, and somebody's kicking the table over there. It's going boom, boom, boom. Okay, don't do that. Jeff and I were talking about banging on the table before we started.
I was looking for how to create the most noise. Yeah, I figured this Sharpie on the mic stand would be the best.
Give him an example.
Well, you know, I started with just this. Uh-huh. And then
pretty isolated. From
and
that.
Then over here. Okay. But then, you know, there's nothing.
Actually, yeah. The fingers were louder and lower, really? And lower frequency. Yeah.
More distracting.
Yeah. You like this?
Yeah. Perfect. So this radio is an example of the late 80s. It's also about 10 channels. This is the 220 megahertz version because I was big on 220 back then. But they had a 2 meter version. They had a 70 centimeter version. And now we've got the volume and squelch and high and low power, but everything else was done with the buttons on the front panel. And that was sort of, oops. Take a look at Cyndi for a while, everybody. That was sort of the end of just being able to pick up one guy's radio and use it. You could pick up the radio and turn it on, and that wouldn't have been too hard, but changing frequencies, there's no channel knob on here anyplace. Oops, bumping the camera. You had to know what buttons to push to get from one channel to another, or get back and forth from memory to VFO, or, you know, program things in. It was hard to do. So I remember what I wanted to say about the synthesizer thing. When the synthesizers were first starting to be developed, and this is where things kind of went wrong. Well, you saw that ICOM IC230, you know, that was a left turn to a dead end. There was an early radio that I have searched and searched and searched for a picture of on the internet and can't find. It was from a company called ICE. And the initials probably meant something, probably international and communications and maybe electronics or something. They developed one of the first frequency synthesized 2 meter radios. Around the era of that FM27B, but this is truly synthesized. And without a dozen crystals or so, and it worked across the entire band. The problem was they never really made it work very well. It was expensive, and of course I bought one. It was 2 meters only, and it was full of spurs. About a third of the channels were unusable because you tuned to it and you had a dead carrier. Jeez. Caused by its own synthesizer. But that's one of the problems with a synthesizer. You know, I'm not an engineer. I don't even play one on TV, but I know that unless you do a lot of work to keep it from generating signals in places where it's trying to hear, that's a problem.
Yeah.
You understand that.
Yeah.
You probably understand why.
Yeah.
here's your close-up camera. Give them the short explanation.
Most of those, well, some of them have to do with the actual shape of the... If you were to follow the actual cosine wave of the voltage being generated, as long as it follows a nice cosine shape, then you have a nice pure output. But if on the way up or on the way down, it takes a little jag, for that instance, it's emitting a different frequency. And if it does that on every cycle, it's going to be strong.
Continuous yeah. Dead carrier. Mm-hmm. Okay. Is there going to be a quiz?
No.
First dual band handheld radio. Notice the size. Extra large economy size radio. This is the ICOM 3280, not the W3280, 3280. First dual band, 2 meters, 440. I think it was still 20 channels or so. I turn it on and show you, but I can't because all the batteries are dead. You know, same group of accessories as the good old 2AT. So across well more than a decade, 15 years of technology, and ICOM stayed consistent, same audio connectors and stuff. So good on you for that icon. And this radio worked pretty well. It synthesizer worked fine. You could scan. All of these radios that had the memories, you could push a button and scan through them. Some of them would scan quickly. Some of them would go chunk, chunk from one channel to another. So this was another pride and joy. And then things started getting smaller. This radio has appeared in a video production of mine. It was, it's now a Ham Radio Now show, or maybe it's just on one of my, it's in the introduction to amateur radio that you and I did back in the mid-90s. Yeah.
Is that the W32?
No, this is the Z1A. It's a dual band radio, and as you can see, if I give you the example, it's getting smaller. So this was the beginning of shrinkage. Mm-hmm. And could no longer be a compatible battery, so it had to be a separate battery. This battery pack remained compatible with a lot of ICOM series radios for a long time. This radio had something extra cool. I'm not sure I can figure out. Oh, yeah, I think I can figure out how to do it. The front panel popped off. And you could put it on a microphone and have a speaker mic. You know, you get the microphone shell and pop the panel off and make yourself. Great idea. This radio went nowhere. Did not sell very many of these. I'm never going to be able to figure out how to put that back together. Here, you guys talk among yourselves while I try to figure this out.
It's fun watching him play with technical things.
It is, yes. He'll get it here in just a minute. Mm-hmm. He won't stop until he gets it back
there
together
was
again.
After that one, there was this W32 that was crazy
that.
Popular. Well, Bobby had a W31. She got not long after she became a ham.
Right.
It looks exactly like the W32, but functionally it's really different.
Here's the W32.
It had some real annoyances.
Yeah. It was a kind of like the enjoy watching Cyndi again for a moment. Smile.
You always get me when I'm doing something.
Sorry. And I won't edit that out either.
Yeah, no, you won't.
Yeah, the W31 was another left turn of just bad design, and they fairly quickly corrected it and sent out this update, but they didn't give you a free one.
No, the W31 is almost unused.
So, that's the end of my memory lane trip of frequency synthesizers. We are now happily synthesized. Well, there is one other thing to say about that, and that is that somewhere in the late 80s to early 90s, HF radios stopped using the VFO and adopted the frequency synthesizers as well. So we went from having a calibrated resolution of, at best, a kilohertz to a calibrated resolution of some radios down to a hertz. Their stability is good. Their accuracy is not a hertz, but it could easily be better than 100 hertz. And most of the radios that I've got, even this old 756 Pro 3, is good to better than 20 or 30 hertz. So that's remarkable compared to where we had been in a quick jump.
See, I'm one of them guys that don't know how good we have it because my first radio was a processor controlled radio, like the Kenwood 450.
Yeah, we got it late.
But the overarching point that I was working on making here was that we made progress and the first ones didn't always work.
Yeah, some of it was painful.
Yeah. And so as we look at the DV4 mobile, the Katana Phoenix white box radio,
right.
Whatever David Rowe is going to call his radio, we're looking at first at some great promises. The ability to do multiple digital modes all at once.
That's pretty cool.
The ability to have an on-channel repeater using time domain technology where you receive and receive for a bit.
Store and forward.
But very rapid. You know, in the old days, a packet store and forward was listen to a signal for 20 seconds, regurgitate it for 20 seconds. Now it's listen to a signal for 20 milliseconds and regurgitate it for 20 milliseconds.
In between, right?
And you don't hear it listening to the output. You don't hear it stutter or anything. You just hear it as if you were listening to it. So you put this thing up on a tower And David Rode described what he was doing to me a year and a half ago, but it was a single, going to be a single frequency. And he hasn't developed the radio yet, still hoping sometime this year. And he's doing his more as a proof of concept. He doesn't want to be the manufacturer that builds thousands and thousands of these. And it's using the free DV digital capability. He's not going to put in everybody else's mode. So again, very proof of concept.
Right.
But using that 5 kilohertz wide, full duplex repeater on one frequency, no duplexer, and it'll cost a couple $100 and stick it up on a tower.
That's pretty remarkable.
And ruin the band because everyone is going to do that. Yeah, I got my repeater up now. Couldn't find an empty frequency, but I stuck it up.
Oh. That radio poses some challenges. It would have to be a synchronous system. It couldn't be asynchronous like every radio we've ever had before.
So it would the transmitter would have to talk, has to talk to the receiver to tell it when to go.
When the switch, yeah. When the burst comes through, it has to be receiving.
Yeah, and that's what Moto Turbo DMR is doing today. It doesn't use its TDMA capability to do a repeater on one frequency. It uses its capability to do two repeaters on one duplexed frequency. So the repeater still needs a duplexer, but it puts two channels in there. And yeah, it's got to tell your mobile, both mobiles, when to transmit so they're not on top of each other because they're on the same frequency.
Yeah, there has to be more. There might be two physical channels, but there would be logical channels because you got to have at least one control channel, right?
Yep. Well, they do it. They do it somehow all on one RF frequency. They don't have an extra control channel.
But I mean, within that frequency, when the burst comes through, some bits but some bits convey signaling.
Yeah. And they have text. It goes along too. Lots of stuff. GPS. It's a brave new world we live in.
Jeez.
I'm afraid.
Well, the thing is, you know, I mean, if you had to make one of them, that thing would cost millions of dollars.
Yeah. So, you know, economies of scale. So, I told you that was going to take a while to get through all that history.
No, that was fun.
And I was going to explain to you why.
And until now, I thought I was really old.
Yeah, I'm feeling better already.
Me too.
I was going to explain to you why everyone uses the word analog wrong.
Okay.
Because an analog is a representation of something. It is not the thing itself. So if you have, when we talk about analog modulation, it is... The RF is an analog of the voice. It is a representation of the voice. If it's AM, it's rising and falling in relationship to the volume, and it's adding sidebands to different frequencies in relationship to the pitch of the voice, doing the same thing on RF. So the RF is an analog of the voice. An FM transmitter is the same thing. It just doesn't rise and fall in power, but it does in frequency. As an analog of the voice that's going into it. My voice itself is not analog. Well, you know, it is. Because the sound waves that are reaching your ears are an analog of the vibration of my larynx.
Right.
The vibration of my larynx is an analog of the thought process in my brain. The thought process in my brain...
I don't know if we want to get into that or not.
No.
But, you know, the definition of words changes with usage as time goes by. And that's what's happened to analog. Analog has come to mean not digital, but even digital.
Are you trying to tell me that the definition of words has literally changed?
Well, I'm not going to get into whether it should or not. But the fact is that it does. A lot of correctness is based on public opinion. When it comes to the maybe, I don't want to say the liberal arts, but things that are not scientific or physical in nature. Now, a lot you only have to listen to a broadcast radio station for a while, and they think that popularity determines correctness in technical matters, too. And, of course, it doesn't.
But digital, you know, in the early days, digital meant had digits on it. Remember the first digital clocks with them little flaps mm-hmm. on there with the yes. numbers that would yes. flip down?
Yes.
And then in around 1976, when things were sampled and quantized, digital came to mean that.
Mm-hmm. So you think that those first clocks with the flaps that went on there, that all mechanical, were digital clocks? They're digital readout, but not digital clocks.
But they still referred to them as digital.
I mean, they were sold as digital, yeah. and I think that's how the term digital came mm-hmm. when things became quantized mm-hmm. and they were called digital. I think it's because the term digital had a foothold in the marketplace.
I thought it would have been because
modern and cool.
It's zeros and ones, which are digits.
Well, by today's meaning, you know, but that didn't come along until after 75. It was in 76 and 77. At least where I was, mm-hmm. that's when digital technology yeah. came about. You know, the T1 line was already out by then mm-hmm. and okay. had been for a number of years.
So I was alive back then, but, oops, another picture of Cyndi. I like that button on the little pad here. I was alive back then, but I knew nothing about these things. I was working on frequency synthesizers and 2-meter band planning. So, yeah, okay, we'll go with that. You got some totally non... technical, well, not
yeah.
not radio technical,
yeah,
ancient yeah, technology you that you want to have.
I have examples of all different kinds of things where advancement was a detriment and things don't work as well, although that could be up for opinion. You want to see that example first?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I have some tools here. Yes. We like tools.
I'm eyeing that. Whoa, whoa, whoa,
whoa. Yeah. I have here two calipers, a digital caliper, an analog caliper. I use the analog caliper because it is more accurate than the digital caliper. And the
what do those things do?
Oh, they measure stuff. They measure stuff. And they're surprisingly accurate. This one can measure things
Hold it up good and high because you're...
This one can measure things to 5/10,000ths of an inch. The nearest 5/10,000ths. In other words, 1/1,000ths of an inch. Meh. This one is calibrated to 1/1,000ths of an inch, the nearest 1/1,000ths of an inch. But you can actually use it to measure within about 2/10,000ths. It's a little more than twice as accurate as this. But in today's world, this is what you see everywhere mm-hmm. because this one requires more skill to use, especially in how to read the various dials on it. And there's more than just the big dial that you have to read. And in this, you only have to read the digits. And I would demonstrate this, but the battery's dead because it hasn't been used in years. The only reason I have it at all is it was given to me.
Yeah, like my handy talk.
There you go. Technology, most people embrace it, think it's 10 times better than this, but...
It's 0.1 times worse.
Well... Yeah, if the battery goes dead, you know, like right now, I can't demonstrate it because it's got a dead battery. But this one I can demonstrate.
Mm-hmm. Measure, don't do that.
I could see how long this show is. Oh, wait.
Oh, wait, you can't do that. It gets off the charts.
So there's an example. That's pretty cool. How about an example of things where technology has improved our lives, but we cling to the old ways because we like it.
Oh, that's ham radio.
The old way is definitely not better, mm-hmm. and it's right here.
Okay.
It's my logbook. Now, it's been many years, and I was not even a ham when it was required by law to log all of your transmission, including CQs, but there was a time, right?
Oh, yes, including CQs.
So that predates me, but this here is a logbook. It's got all my contacts, the HF contacts, and it's pretty interesting. Oh, wow. And why do I do this and not use these cool logging programs? Don't the logging programs work better? Sure they do. They're a lot easier to keep up than this book. But I use this because, to me, validation comes from the way that things have been done before. And I like things that are rich in history and tradition. And that's ham radio for me, mm-hmm. and especially these log books and the modes. You know, I don't transmit in any of these modern modes, not even single sideband, except at greatest need. You know, I like the more enchanting CW. It's just, you know, it puts me in touch with old dudes.
Yeah, it does.
So there's an example where we have technology, but some people just don't embrace, and the technology is better than the old way, but people still embrace the old ways.
Mm-hmm. Not everybody, of course.
No. Well, I think most people don't.
Yeah. I stopped logging the minute the FCC, or maybe a minute before the FCC says you don't have to anymore. But I greatly value the logs that I made in the first couple of years, especially the ones that I made in the first year or so. And I've referred to them back in my 50th anniversary as a ham show. It's called 100 Years of Ham Experience, because I had a guest, Rich Casey, who was contemporary of mine back in Chicago. We talked to each other a lot on 2 meter AM.
50-year ham too?
He was, I was WA9NSO. He was WA9LRI. He was licensed about 6-8 months before I was. So yeah, he was in his 50th year, and I was just, we did the show on the day of my first contact. I don't know the day of the license, because the license grant was, I lost the license. It was in my wallet and was stolen. Mm. I passed the test sometime in like November of 64. The license grant was probably sometime very first day of January 65. And my first contact was around the 17th or so. Right after the license came in the mail. Shiny license came in the mail.
Right.
I got on the air as a novice and failed to make a couple of contacts. Mm. The best contact was with my mentor at the time. And then they came.
He knew your crystal, so we knew where to listen for you.
Yeah, I think I called him on the phone.
Oh.
So yeah.
And we're back to that now, 50 years later.
Yeah, that's true. We're so Tower of Babel, you know, we have no way to know for sure where someone's going to be. So you call them on the phone and say, meet me on whatever.
Yeah.
I do it all the time with your dad. If I'm out on the road, you know, give him a phone call and tell him I'm on 60 meters, channel 3.
So you couldn't just talk to him on the phone. No, I've got to meet him on this frequency.
Well, it's more fun.
Well, the fun, yeah, it's more fun. That's why we do it.
Yep.
Phone calls are fun.
I have another example of a place where technology really doesn't work better, although the general consensus is that it does, and I'm nuts. It's not ham radio. In fact, it's not even electronic. You want to see?
Sure.
And I don't know if you saw me getting this stuff out of the bag or not.
I just spotted over there.
Yeah.
It's that's a relay cleaning device.
Looks like a relay cleaning device, but it's not. It's a brush, and not a dusting brush. It's a shaving brush.
Hmm.
And this is the razor I use most days.
Is that pearl handled?
Yeah.
Look at that.
It's pearlite. It's not real pearl. Okay. It's fake pearl.
Very nice.
But that's the razor I use every day, unless I'm in a hurry.
Traveling on an airplane.
Yeah, I don't take it on the airplane. I do take the brush on the airplane, and it's funny you mention that, because what I carry it in is clearly marked that it's a shaving brush. Well, if I turn it this way, shaving brush, and open this end. And it's to protect the bristles. You know, you don't want the bristles going bad, so I can drop it in there, and it's shaped to fit. It's got holes in it, so if it's a little damp when I pack it up, it can dry out.
Mm-hmm. So attention terrorists, if you want the TSA to not look too carefully at the bomb you're carrying onto the plane, mark it. Shaving brush.
So explain. Yeah. You said that this is better than modern technology.
Well, it shaves better.
Uh-huh.
There's nothing else can shave
No,
you only need one blade. It just has to be a good
Cyndi,
blade.
Cyndi, go ahead and
the big disadvantage.
Check out that baby face.
Oh, that's from this morning now.
Wow. That's impressive.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah, here, check out my...
But the disadvantage is the time it takes. You know, it takes a good 10 minutes to shave with this. So if I'm in a hurry, I just use a double-edged razor. They were called safety razors for many, many years. Mm-hmm. You put a blade in there. And those blades, they're $20 a hundred. So I use them about 3 days and throw them away and put a new one in there.
And this one lasts how long?
There goes my Harry's sponsorship.
Well, it has to be dropped every day, but that thing will last forever. That particular one I actually bought in London. Mm-hmm. I brought back from London because that model you can't get in the States. So I bought it over there. So I've been using that one now since, a year this month.
Wow.
Because that was last August
I got that. Gary, you sure don't want to try
this?
Yeah,
you got to clean it, you know, every day. You run it up and down.
So you're cleaning it, not sharpening it.
Yeah.
You don't sharpen it.
Oh, is that what the leather strap is? Mm-hmm. Okay, I didn't realize. I always thought it was...
It provides just enough cleaning that it will keep it sharp. Indefinitely, you know, if something bad happens to it, you have to hone it. And I've got stuff to do that, but it's I don't do it often enough.
I always thought it was some kind of sex toy.
A what?
Sex toy. The leather strap.
Oh, no, those are somewhere else.
Now the program takes a different turn.
I'm not sure I can mark this program family friendly.
Yeah, so there's the case, you know, that the double-edged razor takes no longer than a cartridge razor, but the shave is much better. You can get a good shave off a cartridge, but you really have to.
Now that straight razor, that is dangerous, right? I mean, you have to handle it carefully. You could cut yourself bad.
Yeah, they're called cutthroats. Now they are remarkably sharp. Yeah. Well, they have to be.
Yeah.
So how long did it take you to stop bleeding?
Well, I never got a really, really bad cut, you know, a little nicks and stuff from it. But it took a few weeks to learn to use it.
He had lots of toilet paper on his face.
Yeah, them little squares.
Tell you what, here, hang on a second. Let me skip that shot. I'm going to come over and Cyndi can compare.
Mine was about 6 this morning.
Okay, and yours was?
This is a Harry's from about 4 this afternoon. So a lot later.
Okay, yeah. Amazing. I mean, Jeff's a little bit, but I mean, considering the amount of time,
I'm trying to save my Harry's account, my potential Harry's account.
That's you're quite smooth. There's a baby's behind, yes.
You know, there's terms for how smooth the shave is.
Oh, really?
Yeah, the worst is SAS, a socially acceptable shave.
Okay.
And then there's a DFS, the damn fine shave. And then there's the baby butt smooth, the BBS.
Okay.
So you're going at least for an SAS, socially acceptable shave.
Yes, it's not that dark, shadowy.
And in... In fairness to the straight razor, my beard doesn't grow very fast. I can get away easily 2 days, second day, and no one's accusing me of a 5 o'clock shadow.
Except I'm just not telling you.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, you could sort of see it, but, you know, I mean, if I'm going to clients, I still don't necessarily shave on the second day.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these days, a light, you know, barely shaved beard is fashionable, except it doesn't work on me because my hair is light enough that I just look like an old man who didn't shave it.
I remember when that became fashionable and electric razors had a knob on them, you could adjust it for 3 to 10 days stubble.
Really? Yeah.
I don't know how they do it today. I guess I don't know how they do it, but you know, to maintain just that very thin beard.
There's got to be a special razor.
Electric razor with the setting on it.
Got to be.
So you use cartridges, right?
I use Harry's. Yeah, cartridge. I did the Gillette. I'd never done, but most of my life I shaved with a electric razor, and it was only 5 or 6 years ago I started using.
Yeah, you're right.
A blade, because I got, you know, all kinds of little bumps and stuff on my face, and it's kind of hard to get around them, but I've learned how. So that or you know, go get them all taken off, and I'm too old for that.
These will take months.
That's where you got that big wad of toilet paper on your chin.
Yeah. So, Cyndi, can you think of anything that just went horribly wrong somewhere in your technology upgrade? I mean, it doesn't have to be ham radio, because your ham radio experiences, for both of you, well, Cindy's is horribly limited.
Well, thank you.
Ham radio now, dedicated to telling the truth no matter how bad it ruins my marriage. I mean, just
I'm just thinking in terms of protocols. I mean, there's some protocols that just really haven't taken off the way that you thought they would, but it's because they just didn't work as well as they were supposed to for what was needed, so... It happens all the time. That's just a natural progression.
The software-ish stuff, right?
Yeah.
Some protocols work well, but were so abused that they can't be used anymore. FTP.
FTP, yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's a good point. Yeah, that's an old workhorse. Still works, but like you say, it's just not secure. Yeah.
All right. Speaking of workhorses, is the workhorse been beat to death here on the show?
I think so.
You know, the one thing we didn't talk about was personal computers and their advancements, most of which have been good. I mean, with each generation that came out, the evolution was good.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't take them seriously in the beginning. I just like, psh. I mean, I knew they'd get
You were in mainframes now.
Well, that's true, but I also knew that eventually that technology would progress and then I would take on. But I just didn't. I refused for a while. And even with like an Apple, it took years before I was comfortable with Apple.
And that was before the iPad. It was, you mean like in the Apple II days?
No, even then, not really. It really wasn't until you got the i and all the Apple products that I started to pay attention to them at that
point. The iPhone is when it really went nuts.
Yeah.
Well, my experience is mixed, like everybody's, because there are things that were buggy. And I used computers never as toys and always as tools. And the most powerful, potent tool that I ever used a computer for was a Power Mac, and it was running software from a company called Avid, video editing. And this was in the mid-90s. We were selling the service that we did, the video editing, on this.
And that's not me hitting the table. That's Mother Nature.
Oh, okay.
A lot of thunder.
Is it coming through? Thunder. Might not be coming through.
I'm hearing rumbling in my phones, yeah. Oh. So we're about to be striking lightning here with all this technology around us. The company I was working for had this software. That and the $3,000 Power Mac ran about $125,000. Very expensive software. Never ran more than 45 minutes without crashing. There were online forums run by the company, by Avid, that Avid apparently paid no attention to. And the users were on there screaming bloody murder. I am selling this. I've got clients sitting behind me. I'm tired of the computer crashing every 45 minutes and losing 10, 15 minutes worth of work, depending on when the last time I did save was. So I got used to saving. I would make an edit and save it. And the save was slow. It's like click.
Well, that was, I mean, it's just like personal computers. That was the same thing, no matter what you were using.
That was more a software issue, though.
Yeah. Well, it was drivers and software and hard drives and stuff. And massive 75 gigabyte hard drives that cost us thousands and thousands of dollars.
I think I noticed something else here. Speaking of old technology, what's sitting right here underneath your hand right now?
Oh, my Palm Pilot.
Palm Pilot, yes.
I love this little thing.
I know. I can't believe it still has it. Well, I should after looking around the room.
I remember when he first got it.
Oh, yeah.
You know how forward-thinking I am?
Mm-hmm.
I had this. And I had this. So the phone for communication and the Palm for mostly a calendar and contact list.
Mm-hmm.
So I kept my calendar and the contact list there, and the phone had its own contact list or phone numbers and stuff. Flip phone. I've got a StarTAC downstairs. I didn't bring it up.
My first phone was a flip phone, but Bobby's wasn't. Bobby had a cell phone before I did.
Do you have a bag phone?
Never had a bag phone.
No. I had a car phone where it was actually bolted into my car, and the unit was back in the trunk. Back in the late 80s, I think it was. Yeah.
Yeah, I remember one time
like a dollar a minute.
It was a Singular, I think, or Bell South
then.
Or somebody.
No, let me Singular think. Was it Bell wasn't South. Singular. It was Cellular One.
It was Cellular One. Whoever ended up as Verizon.
Right.
And I remember one time we were at a Verizon store and they were giving you heat about something, a price or something, and you said, check my start date.
Yeah, check how long I've been your customer.
And the guy looked in his computer for a second and said, I'm sorry, Mrs. Pierce, you're whatever you want.
It was before he was born.
There's a lot of crashes at Cellular One and Triangle Park from our coworkers because they were on that driveway that went down to the buildings where I worked, and they would, you know, people go in and just come out on the driveway and never look for oncoming traffic, thinking that Cellular One was the only thing there. That's once every 2 weeks there'd be a crash there.
Oh, no.
So, speaking of my advanced thought, when I had these two devices, and I got a phone call from a marketing company, and before the iPhone, before any of the smartphones, and they asked me, you know, what technology do you have? And I said, well, I've got the Palm Pilot, and I've got the cell phone. And they said, would you be interested in a device that does all that in one device? No. No, that's stupid. And now, of course, you know, I've got the Nexus 6P. That was my watch.
Yeah, it's a $10 watch. Don't worry about it.
It's a $19 watch. Nexus 6P. And I've been through a progression of smartphones now. Well, actually,
you've been through a progression of smartphones. You haven't looked there. Yes, you have. I watched it.
I had the original Android X. Oh, and then the Galaxy Note 2. And then just three. And those, as advances in technology, I think they've generally been good.
You know, it's surprising. Now, your watch falling on the floor just reminded me that I have tried numerous times over the years shed a watch and have not been able to. I mean, your phone tells you what time it is. These little fitness monitors, well, this one can tell what time it is. All you got to do is mash the button twice to see it. But I've tried and tried and tried to live without a watch. And every time I leave it at home and try to do it without it, I just can't get over it.
Okay, Google. What time is it?
See? She's not listening to you.
She's not listening because she wants my fingerprint. Time is 9:49 p.m. Want my fingerprint.
Oh, yeah. And that only took roughly 100 times as long as it takes me to take a look.
Right.
And is infinitely louder.
Well, it works better when I... Well, it works for the phone to me when I've got the earbuds in. But for me talking to it, yeah, I've got to do the okay...
Yeah, but I mean, it's the getting a phone. I carry my phone in my pocket, so to get the phone out, and you know, I can swipe on it and see the time.
Well, that's why you need the Apple Watch.
But even that, you got to wake it up.
Unless the time is on it where I can just look
constant.
Like that,
it's,
I'm going to struggle with it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not proud of that fact.
Because I'm in front of my computer so much, I just use the computer.
The corner
there, to look at mine. But yeah,
Most of the time I miss it.
I miss mine. Mine just broke recently, so I haven't had it.
Oh,
and
no.
I do miss it. It's okay. It's only a $20 watch. But But it's an effortless experience. Yeah.
My phone wants to tell me where to go to get the official NIST U.S. time. And the world clock.
For a while. And that's the other key. You know, how much accuracy do you need? A minute's fine for me most of the time. But years ago, I struggled making the adjustment to a digital watch, even.
Really?
From an analog.
Hmm.
Because with the analog watch, with a quick glance, could not only see what time it is, but get a feel for what part of the day it is. You know, is it getting ready? Do I have time to start one more job before getting ready to go home?
Yeah.
Should I try to wrap this up because getting on lunchtime? Mm-hmm. And you can tell all that without even knowing what time it is. Just by,
that's a good point.
Just
I hadn't
by
thought
the
about
shape
that.
Of what you see.
Yeah.
And then
do.
When the digital comes along, you actually have to make the translation, which now, you know, happens automatically and subconsciously, but it didn't initially.
So what does your digital watch tell you about the time of day and how long things have taken and whether or not we should abandon the rest of the show? Time to go.
Well, yeah. Tells me that Bobby's going to be Tuckies before I get home.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we've been going on quite a long time. But it's been fun, right? Like a typical Ham Radio Now show that wanders around the subjects. And you know, folks have not had us three just bantering for a long time.
Yeah, it was fun to see your radios that run off kerosene and stuff because it wasn't electricity then.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah.
Wind-up toys.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah.
So let's finish things up. We'll remind people of the Kickstarter. Have I still got that on the screen? Let's see if it is. Let me refresh here and see if anything has happened while we were gone. Nope, still sitting at 38 backers at 35, 25, and it's 21 Sunday night. Days to go. HamRadioNow.tv is the place to go and do the thing. Appreciate it. If you're thinking of making a contribution, I had somebody make a contribution through the PayPal, and he said he just doesn't like Kickstarter, so he hopes this helps. The contribution helps, and if the Kickstarter is successful, it's all good. But if the Kickstarter's not, then I got $20, which is a very nice contribution, but no $5,000. So, you know, somewhere it's all got to work. But I think where we're sitting right now, at you know, $3,500, two $500 corporate level contribution rewards are still available, and. Tell if you know a ham radio company that you think would like to have their name mentioned for about 15 seconds or so at the beginning of each Tapper program and thereby being associated with this prestige operation. You guys smile.
And can I make a plug that give me a week without my husband?
Yeah, because I'm gone for like a week.
Yeah.
Traveling.
Yeah.
Bobby will make the dinner list.
Okay.
Be nice and quiet. All right. We'll close the program. And the three words that close the program, I will now assign. I will do the first word. Jeff will do the second word. Cyndi will do the third word.
Okay.
Cyndi's wondering if she knows. It's time to get there. Tell everyone who is here. Close up, Mr. DeMille. Who are you?
I'm KD4ACW.
And who are you?
I'm Jeff AC4ZO.
And I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over.
And
out.
Whoops, screwed it up. Okay, I'll do it with this shot. Over.
And.